All right.
Backstage with Michael Jackson, as close to his private world as you could ever hope to get. People are always asking about the man behind the myth. But in this electric moment, is there really any difference? If you want to find out more about the real Michael Jackson, you start here, at his magical launching pad, and let yourself be part of the illusion. Voltage performance wired up to another world. The man they call Pop's Peter Pan is in full flight. If there was ever a pure entertainment machine, you're watching it. Watching him on stage and the power of his performance, I remembered the shy kid I interviewed in New York for Countdown in 1977.
Do you regret having to keep up with his schoolwork?
No, I enjoy it. I love to read and learn and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, over in Australia, we've seen you on many of the big shows, like the big music awards and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
And your little sister's been on a few of them.
Oh, yeah.
She's a funky little sister.
She's funky.
Amazing.
Even back then, he'd already come such a long way. The son of a crane driver from industrial America, tripping the light fantastic when his friends were struggling in school plays, the boy who was born to sing knew nothing but the stage. At the time I talked to him, he was getting ready to rock with you. And tens of millions of records after. The song remains the same, but the singer has become far more elusive. Waiting in a Tokyo hotel room, I still can't quite believe that of all the world's press, Michael's agreed to talk to me again. His first major TV interview this decade. But you don't get this deep inside the fortress without conditions. Strict limits on time, even the number of questions. I took Michael back to our interview all those years ago.
You had a lot of aspirations at that time, a lot of dreams. Would it be fair to say that a lot of those dreams over the last 10 years, because it was in 1977, that interview, have come true for you?
Most of my dreams seem to come true, and I'm so thankful that they do. I don't know over what period of time, but I I have lots of dreams and they usually come true, and I'm so glad.
Thousand fans on a warm September night watch Michael set music alight. Tonight it's Tokyo, an inkling of things to come when his Magical Mystery World Tour hits Australia in November. Even if his music is not your style, few can resist the Lord of the Dance.
I dance a lot anyway. I've always loved to dance. When I was just real little, I used to watch Sammy Davis, Fred Astaire, and James Brown, and just dancing about the house. So I don't remember not dancing.
Like all superstars, Michael has to deal with a plague of allegations about his private life. Headlines which paint him as a weird recluse. Rumours about his supposedly mammoth plastic surgery. About his supposed fascination for bizarre relics like the Elephant Man. How much of it is true? Ask the question, and you meet Michael's manager, cigar-smoking Frank DeLeo. He joined the interview as Michael's friend and chief minder. Now, about those headlines.
Does it affect you? Does it hurt you to see some idiotic stories that are written?
Yeah, I'll answer that question if you don't mind. It hurts me. And if it hurts me, I know it hurts Michael. He's a little more blasé about it than I am. I mean, he just sort of shrugs it off. But I find it very terrible that some of the stuff that is written, particularly about plastic surgery, and all of it is garbage and rubbish. And, if that's the best thing that's the only thing they can figure out to do with their life, then, you know, they're pretty sick people.
Avoiding the spotlight off stage for this most wanted star requires some extraordinary escape routes. And in talking to us, Michael at least confirms one of those myths, that he dons disguises to slip unseen into the real world.
I like to sneak into theaters without being noticed sometimes. Sometimes there's really nothing you can do about it. It's the price you have to pay.
Well, I've heard sometimes you turn up in the most unexpected places to your friends dressed in that they don't even recognize you.
I have incredible disguises. I can fool my own mother. And I enjoy doing it because I get to see life the way it really is sometimes, which is fun.
But when Michael does step out as himself, it's an event. While in Tokyo, we were lucky enough to catch a rare glimpse of Michael's home video, showing a Jackson shopping spree. Together with a few select friends, Michael has a huge department store to himself.
It's the same as blowing into. Well, you can't. It's not the same as.
Can't get any sound out of it.
You need about 3 years of practice to really get the sounds out.
When you're locked inside the four walls of fame and looking out at the crush of fans looking in, there's nothing quite as precious as one true friend. In Michael's case, that friend is Quincy Jones. They met on the film set of The Wiz.
I met Michael at Sammy Davis's house when he was about 12. Mm. And you just fall in love with Michael at any age. And The Wiz was when we really connected. And he was a scarecrow, and he'd pull out bits of paper, quotes from Confucius, etc., all these great philosophers. And one time he says, blah, 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 sign, Socrates. And he kept saying, Socrates, 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 and nobody would correct him. And after a while, I took him over to the side. I said, Michael, forgive me, but it's Socrates, you know. And at that moment, our eyes met, and something happened that's never changed since then.
Quincy Jones has produced Michael's three major solo records, including pop's biggest selling album of all time, Thriller.
Were you aware of the sales? That, like, did you yes. check up on sales each week and realize that it was doing this?
I pretty much did the album and just sat back and watched because it was another one of my dreams. I knew it was going to do what it did.
Selling over 40 million copies, Thriller not only changed the way music was made, but also video clips. But perhaps one of Michael's greatest influences has been on dance. He took breakdancing out of New York's ghettos and made it a passion for his generation.
Did that amuse you that people were, or did it flatter you that people were trying to do your dance steps? And
I always love watching that, especially the children when they wear all the gear and everything and imitate me. I think it's fun. Stunning good taste is fun.
He's been called everything from the Frank Sinatra to the Fred Astaire of the 80s. The spotlight has made him music's first billionaire. All that at 29.
He's like a laser beam all the time. He always does his homework. I've never ever seen him nervous about anything. I called him just before he went on this show. This is his first solo tour ever. I said, "You nervous?" He said, "No, I can't wait to get on stage tonight."
Clichés seem to fall away when you watch Michael perform. When he says he's inspired by things spiritual, you believe him. And when he says that four-letter word, love, you believe that too.
Yeah, I love children and animals and Quincy and Frank. Quincy. And that's what's so wonderful about traveling. I get to see all the cultures and people and the children. It's wonderful. It's my greatest inspiration, I would say.
It was that sense of humanity that inspired Michael to sit down with Lionel Richie in the summer of 85 and write this. I was lucky enough to be at the recording of We Are the World, and even amongst the greatest collection of superstars ever gathered, all eyes were on Michael, the pitch-perfect performer who seemed to be singing out a dream. It's true, we make a better
day. I said I wanted to be something like an anthem where it would affect the whole world, you know, where everybody could sing it and have such melodic simplicity to it where it'd be where a five-year-old child could sing it and like it, that type of thing. And as I remember waking up from my sleep the next morning before putting it down, really, most of the song was there, and I went in the studio and kind of did a demo and presented it. And first Quincy asked me to do it with Lionel, you know. And I remember calling Quincy, telling him I had the tape. And then Lionel put some lyric to it. And I hate saying who did what, but it always sounds
so... No, something of interest, though.
But just when you thought it was safe to call Michael Pop's good boy, he comes up with this. The squeaky clean superstar who takes his rock and roll without the sex and drugs has called his latest album Bad. In a world where he could have cashed in on his fame overnight, Michael spent 6 years making Bad sound exceptionally good.